Tom, it's a good day. It's turned out in the end.
Yeah, a great day. Now, this week's Boxing News, there was a story about Del Fontaine. Well, that gentleman there, Freddie Tilston, from Chester, fought in Canada and the States, and he was a friend of Del Fontaine's. Now, Del Fontaine got hung in Great Britain over murdering a lady friend. Now, I saw a photograph many years ago of Fred with Del Fontaine and Del's wife and three children in Canada. Del Fontaine in those days, we put it this way, they were fighters, was just like a piece of meat. And Del Fontaine fought in America, he fought Mickey Walker, he got stopped in four rounds, he fought some good ones. Fred always said he could have been a cracker himself. But what I'm saying to you is this, that Del Fontaine was definitely punch drunk. Now, he worked his passage over here to box over here. He was finished really when he come here. He shouldn't have been allowed to box anymore. Now Fred, he had over 250 fights. He was over in Canada and the States for 7 years. He won a title twice in America under different names. One was under his own name of Freddie Tilston. And when he was going through, there was a bit of trouble. He also won the title. He took his father's first name and his mother's surname under the name of George Griffiths. And of course, the people who wanted after Fred for money saw the photograph of him and as George Griffiths and realised it was Freddie Tilston. Anyhow, that's another story, but Del Fontaine worked his passage over here. Now, Del Fontaine fought a lot of good people, but he was mismanaged. Fred Tilston's manager, when he was in Canada and America, was a Manchester man by the name of Ennie Fingard. Now, Fred Tilston topped the bill at the old Pudsey Street Stadium 50 times before he was 21. He was in the States and Canada before he was 21. His first fight in Canada, he got beat. His mother had just died when he got the message. He fought a man from Minneapolis called Bobby O'Shea. Bobby O'Shea committed, well, there was a no foul rule then, and he was hitting Fred before, below the belt and everything. The second time they fought, Fred told me the story of he said to Bobby O'Shea, he said, "I want you to keep the punches up," and Bobby O'Shea said, "I'll kick you in the balls if I can get away with it." But Fred beat him the second time. Now, there's also the story here I told you about the three Spencer brothers. That is Billy Spencer, my great friend of my father's. Billy Spencer got the MM at Anzio. That photograph there with his brother Charles, who was superimposed. Charles was already dead. He died in the Second World War. I believe that was at Anzio as well. And that is Tommy Spencer, the one that won the welterweight, middleweight and the heavyweight championship in the same championships. Tommy was also a boxing referee and a big friend of the legendary Irish boxer Harry Perry. Tommy Spencer was an immaculate boxer. In fact, he had the scars inside his mouth, and he showed them me of when he sparred with Fred Tilston, and Fred used the elbow on him. I asked Fred if this was true, and Fred said, "Yeah." He said he was making a fool of me. Now, and when you get a man that topped the bill at Liverpool Stadium and scored 28 knockouts there, saying that, it just shows you how good Tommy Spencer was. Now, we've also got a very interesting photograph here. This is of a gentleman from Cheetham Hill called Joe Finneran. Joe Finneran also boxed in America, and if the truth's known, he had 28 fights over there and lost two on disqualification. Now, it just shows you that if they people played a bit rough with Joe, Joe could play a bit rough himself. Now, I got to know Joe very well. One reason, I was travelling, working as a bricklayer up and down the country, and I worked a lot with Manchester people, especially a lot from Salford, like Matty Calderwood, who had two nephews, the Calderwood brothers. One was Brian, I think the other one was Barry, that's it, Brian and Barry. And then there was Stanley Hendricks, whose brother Ernie Hendricks was a very, very good boxer prior to the war. Well, how I got in touch with Joe, or how I got to know Joe, is I went to work at Worksop, and everybody else was two in a room, and for some unknown reason, nobody was in Joe's room, so I ended up in Joe's room. People asked me how I got on with him. I said he was well, because Joe sometimes would do a little bit of shadow boxing. Lee Sullivan's father was battling Jim Sullivan, who had a boxing booth. The best prospect, or he was prospect at the time, they always thought that Sammy Sullivan was the boxer that was going to make it out of the Sullivans, not Johnny. But Johnny won the title. Now, when he wrote his life story, he told people, and he said how when he was in the booth with his father, he challenged all comers, he said, and this man took him on and gave him a boxing lesson as a southpaw. The next day his father tells him all about southpaws and how you handle them and everything like that. The following night, who should turn up again but the same man? And he gave him a boxing lesson, this time orthodox. That man was Joe Finneran from Cheetham Hill. Joe, in my opinion, was one of a true gentleman. I used to go out with him. I never used to drink then. I used to go out with him, have a glass of lemonade, and we'd come home at night when we were working away. And Joe was one of the a great guy and a great gentleman. I owe Joe a lot. Now on this,
what happened to Joe?
Well, he must be dead now. He lived in Norton Street in Cheetham Hill. That's where he lived. The last time I saw him would be in the 70s. I mean, to be quite honest, I've got to wait you, tell you the truth. I hit the skids myself. I ended up an alcoholic. I mean, I wouldn't go, I've got to be honest about it. I was at death's door when I was 50 years of age. I'm 79 now. I've had nearly 30 years. I mean, I've got over cancer. I've been able to, when I married my wife, I was a looked down as a respected person. I ended up a laughing stock, but I got myself back. And it was only through the likes of these people, the likes of the Spencer, to Billy Spencer, my family, and the discipline I'd had with boxing, the likes of the discipline through Fred Pickering. I don't care what anybody says, it's what you learnt earlier on in life. And I didn't realise how fortunate I'd been when I went to my first boxing club, being put in the hands of the likes of Fred Tilson and Fred Pickering, Tommy Barlow, people like that. Because it's only when you go around you realise how fortunate you've been. You know, and this is what it's all about.
You know, when you battle with the alcohol,
yeah.
You know, and it, obviously, you know, you've often referred to it as the toughest battle that you ever had.
Yeah, it is, because it was. I mean, I'll be honest with you now. You see, I mean, I've never took drugs, but if I was a drug addict, I'd have to go to me the fella was getting them off. Whereas when you're fighting a drink, the drink's everywhere. It's in your corner shops. It's in people's houses. It's there 24 hours a day. It's in the supermarket. You don't have to go to the pubs or anything. You don't have to go looking for it. It's there. I mean, I'll be honest with you now. It nearly killed me, giving it up. Because I'll tell you this straight. I couldn't go to Alcoholics Anonymous. Because if you've got a name, there's no anonymity. There's nobody. Anonymous doesn't come into it. Right? I went there. Everybody knows. So, if it had gone into rehab, that would have been a challenge to get it in. So I knew I had to do it on my own. And I'll tell you this straight, I got an allotment up the top there. It hadn't been done, like this one hadn't been done, for years and years. My hands was thin. You work your fingers to the bone. So you get tired and go to sleep, you'd wake up after half an hour. And your guts would be gnawing, the rats would be gnawing at your guts. So you'd take the dog for a walk, he was at death's door, it took ages. But in the end you started seeing the light. I didn't do any work or anything, just the allotment, because I knew if I started work again, everything can be mortgaged. The first week, I got a pay packet. The boss said to me, Tommy, I'll get you the taxi home. I said, no, I've got to walk with the money in my pocket past the pubs. It took me 2 hours to walk from Liverpool Road to Hambridge. I saw people who I hadn't seen for ages. Tommy, come in for a drink. Come in, and I knew I couldn't go in. And I'll tell you this straight. Every time I hit a pub, it was a challenge. And every time I walked past it, it was a relief. I got home, I took my donkey jacket off, it was winter. I was grey as a ghost, and my wife had to cut my shirt off my back and everything. We got my pullover off, we had to cut the shirt off my back. I was sweating, but I knew I'd done it. I'd walked past the pubs with money in my pocket, and I was on my way. And, you know, it was a great feeling. I mean, I'll tell you this straight, years later, there was a lot of trouble and the fight was on. And I'll tell you this straight, a fella said to me, Tommy, I'll send somebody over to look after. I said, look, if you've got to send somebody over to me to look after me, I said, you may as well send me a crate of whiskey. I said, and I'll drink myself to death. I said, I shook hands with the devil fighting for the drink and I'm frightened of no man. And I'll tell you this straight, when my wife was targeted, somebody had used her ID for a load of money, Bailiffs was due to come round. Okay, I knew people. I can't go into too much. But I said then, my wife broke her heart all night. Somebody was going to pay. And I'll tell you this straight, when it kicked off, my daughter had been laughed out. My daughter, Sandra, had been laughed out of a police station in Thames Valley when she said there might be a bloodbath. I went to the police and I told them what had happened, and it wasn't my wife's death or anything like that. They didn't want to know, so it was on. And I'll tell you this straight, when the bloom went up, I was the last man standing. And that's what it's all about. You believe me, that was some fight with the drink. But I'll tell you one thing, if you can fight the drink, you're not worried about anybody. Because you've been through hell and back. And you're not going to take it again. Now, I'll tell you straight. I respect the drink. If I go in a pub and have a glass of lemonade, or it's a boxing show and have a glass of lemonade, and I go to the toilet, I will change that glass. I will not touch it, just in case there's anything in. I'm still frightened of that drink, because never mind what anybody tells you. They'll say, oh, I can handle it. No, you can't. If you're a proper Anglican, if you're a proper plonky and all this, that and the other, you'd only need one drink and just start again. You believe me. That's one opponent. And you can't play around with that fella. It's like being in the ring with a fella can put your lights out with either hand. You don't take any chances. I mean, I'll be honest with you, I've levelled my heart out over that. Because a lot of people say, oh, you shouldn't tell people you're an alcoholic. What do you mean, you shouldn't tell them? I won't even have a piece of Christmas cake unless I know there's nothing in it. I won't even have a piece of, you know, Christmas pudding or a mince pie unless I know there's nothing in it. Because I'll tell you this straight, I don't want to go through that again. If I'd have known what I've had to go through, I'm sure I'd have taught myself.
Does it get to a point where there's no going back with a drink?
Yeah, you know.
Once you get to that level.
I mean, I'll be honest with you now. I was at death's door through the drink, and I was at death's door when I was getting over it, because you can't get to sleep hardly. And I'll tell you what happened. There was one, I was fortunate. My doctor is a big person in alcohol abuse and drug abuse. And he said to me, if ever you get, he said this, and he gave me his home number. Well, I was forgetting everything, and there was one day, I had a lot to do with stabbing your bull terriers, and there was this day, Mikey Brody had a dog off me. I give Mikey one, I give young Thompson's father one. And what happened was this, that this day I went at work, and I stood on I dreamt I'd been at this dog show, and I woke up in the morning. And I had a hell of a hangover. But I'd never had a hangover when I was drinking, because I was perpetually pissed off. Anyhow, what happened was this, the missus said, you're right. I said, don't soft soap me, I know I was out of order. I dreamt I was at a dog show, was with Jerry Burns and all the lads, and I could feel the whiskey going down. Anyhow, I get to her, and it was with Harry Pete, a lad from Manchester, from Liverpool, and Felix, another lad from Liverpool. He used to stop at the office and get half a bottle of whiskey before it started, and then dinner time in the pub, and then night on the way out. Anyhow, they said, did you have a drink last night? I said, I couldn't tell you. Well, you've done well anyhow, you've been off it 6 months, or so, 3 months. I said, oh yeah, 6 months it was. And I said, yeah. Anyhow, are you having one? I said, no. So anyhow, I was on the scaffold. I had a brick in one hand, and a towel of mortar in the other. I didn't know what to do with them. And I've been a bricklayer all my life, since I was 15. I was in a right state. Dinner time, get your heads. He said, well, come and have a live, and he said, and you know, like. I said, no. I said, give me a load of stuff. I said, load me up. I said, if I don't feel any better when you come back, I said, run me into the village, I'll go home. My head cleared about 1 o'clock. Goes home that afternoon, you know, at night. My wife says, what was up with you this morning? I said, Mag, I said, I don't know. She said, you was with us last night, you was watching the television. I said, this is no good, this. I said, I'm in a worse state now than when I was drinking. So, I phoned the doctor up and he come. I said, look, I said, I'm leaving me glasses everywhere, I don't know what I'm doing. And I tells him about it. He said, you're getting better. I said, if I'm getting better. I said, he said, what's it like? He said, no. He said, what's happened? He said, for years you've been doing everything by repetition. He said, now you're starting to think for yourself and you're not being run by the drink. And you know what? I started to get better. And then the woman rang me up, she asked me to do a job for her. And you couldn't say who the so-and-so were you like. She said, oh, you've done a job for me 2 years ago, and over the moon with it. I said, well, listen, I'm a bit stuck for a lift. I said, oh, yes, she said, and she picked me up. And do you know what? I'd done this job. And it was immaculate. I couldn't even remember doing it. This is no joke. And I thought, if I'd done that when I was pissed up, how the hell am I going to match it now I'm sober? And you know what? it was true. What that doctor said was true. For years I'd worked. You see, the drink affects people in different ways. It can affect people's work, and then other people, it affects the nature. My wife was more worried in case I'd lost my sense of humour. But, you know, it was a funny thing.
What advice would you give to anyone who's in your position fighting a drink?
Well, to be quite honest, everybody's different. Your metabolism, that's the thing, that is the thing. There is no, you can't give people a tablet, because everybody's metabolism is different, isn't it? You see, it's a matter of willpower. I was fortunate. A lot of it is who you've got as friends and what sort of discipline you've got. I was lucky. I mean, I had the discipline through boxing, the will to win. It was just like when my wife was targeted. I didn't worry about them so-called bailiffs. If they wanted it, they could have as much as they wanted. When you've been through that, you've had the discipline. It's just like my wife was telling Mick and John. There's a fella that opened his mouth to me one day and I chinned him good style. Big fella. Right, he's come. Right, I'll tell you straight now. When you get somebody trying to bully you, and you've been in there with good fellas, it's like flashes in front of you. You think of all the handy lads you did fight. On the up. Good fighters. And you get a clown like that, shouting and bawling, and all of a sudden, when he hits the floor, he starts crying to the police. It's like, you know, I mean, I'll be quite honest with you now. It's the discipline you've got, and you can't let go. I mean, I feel sorry for anybody, because I'll be... Think what I learned. I never drank naturally when I boxed or anything like that. But thinking back, it doesn't take you long to be an alcoholic. I reckon within 6 months I was an alcoholic.
Once you stop boxing and start drinking.
Yeah.